Hi, welcome to what I hope is the first of many instructional videos for you this year. I really want this to become a regular part of our class where I can give you something to look at outside of class other than a textbook where I'm explaining things, and you can then stop, go back, rewatch it as you need to in order to understand a concept. This first video is going to be on metaphrasing, gapping, and verb endings, which I hope is a review for a lot of you. But some of you still might be iffy on some of these things, so I'm hoping that this might help clarify some things. The verb endings especially are new to some of you, or all of you for that matter, and I hope that it helps to get you to understand them. So here we go. All right, let's take a look at metaphrasing now. So when we start with metaphrasing, we immediately think, okay, we need our SVDO model, right? This is our basic transitive sentence pattern, okay? So most sentences we see are going to have a subject, a verb, and a direct object. So we take a look at this first one. We see we have filios et dominos, and we see we have filios is an accusative. We have our conjunction, okay, meaning it connects two things. We have an accusative on one side, and we say, okay, we have an accusative on the other side. We also then have accusative plurals and a conjunction connecting them. We still need a subject, we still need a verb, although now because we have accusatives we have our direct objects, right? So when we're looking at this we say subject, verbs, the sons, and the masters. Notice we don't have our subject and our verb, so we just leave those as our variables S and V. Which also notice the detail. These are accusative plurals. In the English, we have plurals, okay? So be very specific about what you're doing when you're metaphrasing. I'd love to put these on vocabulary tests because you have to translate and you have to be very specific and you have to know what they're doing in a sentence. It tests your Latin abilities and your abilities to know, to memorize vocab. So it's a really, really good exercise. Impedit furem. Here, we say, okay, we have our T ending on impedit, probably have a verb. We have an EM ending on furem. That probably means direct object because it's accusative, right? So what are we missing? We're still missing our subject, so we have to leave that as our S. We do have our verb this time. Okay, so subject impedes, and then what does the subject impede? We have our direct object, it impedes the thief. I hope this is coming pretty clearly, but this next one is going to be a little bit trickier. If we look at your chart, this ES ending on ocasiones, ocasiones is going to be two things. It can be nominative plural or accusative plural. Remember, this is from the third declension. So that ES ending is going to mean two things. So we have two possibilities. We have two answers here. We're going to have the opportunities verb, the DO, or subject plus verb, the opportunities. Remember again, we have plurals because we have our nominative or accusative plural here. Okay? I want you to also note, like I said before, we're translating these into English as we do the metaphrase. Okay, so we're basically building a translation without knowing exactly what the whole sentence is. Okay? Okay, let's go to the next slide. Alright, so let's take a look at gapping again. Remember, gapping is what occurs when you have things in another clause that you still need in this clause, and you're gonna assume that they're there, okay? So this is where your metaphrasing expectations are going to come into play. If you're expecting a direct object and you don't have one, but there's one in the clause next to it, you're going to take that direct object out because you don't want to be redundant in Latin, just like you don't want to be redundant in English. We don't say, I want to go to the store and I want to buy milk and I want to buy cheese and I want to buy butter. You assume the I want to buy, and you would say, I want to go to the store and buy milk, cheese, butter, etc., etc. So keep that in mind. Note that we're dealing with a language. It's not just a series of words that we're dealing with that are kind of like a puzzle. All right. So let's look at this. Look at this first one. We can say, okay, we have fuhr is a nominative, so let's label it as our subject. Fuhrem is our accusative with the em ending, so we're going to use that as a direct object. And cognoscit with our t ending, all right, we're gonna deem as a verb. So we have a full clause here, svdo. We can end a sentence here, except when we see et, it keeps it going. Just like when in English you hear and, you're expecting something else. So over here we have lupus, okay, and we say, okay, that's a us ending, it's got to be the subject. And we see lupum with the um ending, that means it has to be accusative, it means it's the direct object. What are we missing on that, on the side of the et? We're missing our verb. So if we're missing a verb on one side, but we have one over here, what we do is gap. Cognoscit over here. And that acts as your verb. So now we can say the thief knows a thief and a wolf knows a wolf. Now, even in English, we might say a thief knows a thief and a wolf a wolf. That makes sense in English too, but we do need to understand that cognoscit still applies here, okay? Let's take a look at the second one. Vitam fortuna regit non sapientia. Now, just like the last sentence here, we have our direct object, our subject, and our verb. So we have all three parts in the first part of this. Non sapientia, we have kind of as a tack onto the end of the sentence. And this is just nominative. It's so we just have a subject, which means we have to gap in our direct object, vitam, and our verb, regit. Okay? Now, I also want to point out that we can just as easily have our subject, our verb, and our direct object all over here and only have our subject over here. We can gap backwards. That is possible. All right. In English, that doesn't really happen as much, but in Latin, that's just as common, okay? So just be aware, it can go both ways. It can go backwards and forwards in Latin. All right, so let's take a translation break here and say, fortune rules life. Sapientia does not. Again, you hear in the English that we're gapping in the life and the ruling, but we still have to say sapientia, the new subject. The idea is something like fortuna rules life. Fortune, sorry, rules life. Wisdom does not. Okay? All right, so just keep in mind, final thoughts on gapping. It's just a giant use of expectations. If you expect something else and it's in another clause, bring it in. Just like we did up here with cognoscit, where you're expecting a verb up here, we brought in the one from the other side. Over here, we expected a direct object and a verb. We don't have them over here, so we bring them over, okay? I want to point out, though, this is just recognition of something that we always do naturally. So if this naturally comes to you and you think this is really stupid and obvious, yes, but I do want you to be able to tell me that thing that's obvious, which is why we're doing gapping. Okay? Next slide. All right, so when we are looking at a verb, we have to note that there's two parts. There's the root and the ending. The ending right here is going to give us everything we need to know about that verb, such as tense, voice, mood, anything like that, person, number. It's basically going to tell us everything except what the verb itself means. The root is going to give us the definition, okay? So when you're looking at vocabulary, you should know the root. If you're looking at a text and you need to know a specific form for a translation, that's when you start looking at the ending. You put the two together and you get a nice complete verb, both with tense, voice, mood, person, number, etc., and a meaning of the verb, okay? So, if we're looking at regere, we'll be able to conjugate that verb with the following endings. All right, so you get your OST, mustisnt. Now these guys are the present active endings of the verb. You'll notice that a lot of other verb forms are very similar or the exact same as these. So these are where we really need to start when we're learning verb forms. Okay. So in the first singular, you'll see up here we follow the same pattern. This is your O ending. We have rego. And rego means I rule. Notice we have our first person singular. In the first person singular, we translate with I. First person means it's coming from the person who's talking. And the singular way to do that in English is to say I. The first person plural way to do that is to say we. So let's do that one right now. This is where we get regimus. And you see that mus ending just like we had up here. Okay. And you'll note that we're mirroring these endings down at the bottom. But this regimus form means we rule. Okay? So, we can go down the list here. We can say regis, with that S ending. Now, second person is the person nearby the first person. And the person you're talking to, so you're going to say you, okay? Rule. Similarly, in the plural, we would say you in English, but if you're in the South, you'd say y'all, okay? So, regitus is y'all rule. I say y'all because it is a dialect form of English, and it's really the only dialectal form we have that distinguishes between the singular and the plural, because we, in the North, we don't use y'all as much. We say you rule or you rule, and we just use context to decide whether it's singular or plural, okay? If you prefer a northern-southern hybrid, you can say you all, okay? But you you might get into trouble later when we actually learn the word for all, so be careful with that. Now third singular, you guys have seen these already. These are your T endings. I want to note that the third person are the ones where you can have any entity in the world that is not I or you. So if it's not the person that's talking or the person directly being addressed, it's going to be the third person. So everything, idea, or anything else in the universe really that isn't the speaker and isn't being addressed, that's the third person, okay? We usually just say he, she, or it rules, okay? Now, third plural, we need to add an NT to that. So it's regunt with a UNT. Now, you might say, well, our vowel has changed. We went from O's to I's to U's. This is part of something that we're going to go to the next slide called conjugation number, and that's going to, it's going to be another whole set of patterns that you're going to have to know. So after I write this one right here, we'll continue to the next slide, and we'll go from there. I also want to point out that we do have to conjugate our English verbs as well when we're doing these. So I want to see he, she, it rules, but they rule with no S. Okay, so make sure that you make sense when you translate it. Don't just write whatever you think. We'll get you the right answer. If it doesn't make sense in English, it's not going to. All right, so let's go to the next slide. All right, so as I discussed in the last slide, we need to know what verb or what vowel you're using. So in every verb, we're going to be using one of four sets of vowels before our endings. And you just saw rego regere, which had I's and a U, and that might have been confusing to some of you, so as promised, here's the slide to explain. So in the last slide, we had rego regere. All right, so when we look at any verb in the dictionary entry, we're going to want to look at this right here, that ending. That ending is going to tell us whether or not, whether it is part of the first, second, third, or fourth conjugation. These are the four patterns you're going to have to follow, okay? Now, I'll tell you right now that rego regere is in the third conjugation down here, so let's not worry as much about that right now while I explain these next two, okay, or these first two. So first conjugation is made up of A's. Your vowel is going to be an A, okay? And you guys know lavo, lavare, okay? And I want you to look at this right here. Notice the difference between rego up here with the ere ending and here with the are ending. So when you see the are ending, you know that you're going to be using A's. So what's it going to look like? Well, you still have lavo. Now, I want to point out that the O typically is the thing that looks the same in all the conjugations. You do not put an A here, okay? You do not insert an A between the V and the O here. That does not happen. It is just lavo with an O, all right? Now, your second person, all right, you're going to have lavas, okay? So that would be you wash. I wanted you to note that A right there, okay? Whereas we had regis before with an I, this we have lavas with an A. And you might start to see a pattern here. We have a lavat. Notice the T ending is still the same, but we use that A because we're in the first conjugation. Lavamos, it's a U. Lavatis, lavant. Okay, this one is pretty easy because you have A's all the way across other than that O. Okay, and that's going to be the same with these first two conjugations. We're going to be set on one vowel except for the O in the first one. Okay, so the first person singular here is going to be the exception to putting vowels in, but it's actually easy because this form right here in the dictionary entry is that first person singular, okay? So any dictionary will have first singular, and then this is called the infinitive, and that's what we're using to decide, okay? So let's look at the second conjugation. You guys actually do not yet know a second conjugation verb, so I'm going to give you one right now. Videre, videre. Now this means to see, in case you're wondering. But I want you to note this E right here, okay? That makron, that little line above it, means that it's a long E. And contrast that with rego regere, which has a short E ending, okay? It's going to be very important to know because we're going to have different vowel endings with those, okay? So if we look at wideo for IC, you do have, again, your first part of your dictionary entry as the first person singular. In this case, it does have an EO on it, and not all of them will, but a lot of them will. So, you know, I would always look at that second part of the dictionary, not as much the first. This one, we happen to get that E there anyway. All right. We have widdes with an E, widdet with an E, widdemus with an E, and you see where this is going. We actually did the exact same thing as in the first conjugation, except we did it with an E instead. Okay? Not too bad so far, I hope. But remember, we're looking at that dictionary entry for a clue as to what vowel we're going to use. Now, the third conjugation is where it starts to get a little tricky because we're going to start switching stuff up. As if you recall from the last slide, where I gave you your endings, you're going to have I's and a U, and it's going to be a little odd. So we'll use the dictionary entry up here. Okay. We see, we have a short ERE here, right up here. Not a long one. So notice the little line over in the second conjugation. It's not up in the third one. So that means it's a short ERE. Okay. Again, we have the first part of our dictionary entry is the first person singular, I rule. We have IS, IT, IMUS. Itis, UNT, okay? Note, we have four I's and a U. So, if you want help remembering this, O, four I's, U. Which is insulting to those of us that wear glasses. So, if you want, you can insult me as I have my glasses on and say, oh, four eyes you, because I'm a little crazy. That's okay. So, yes, you can do that. Let's talk fourth conjugation now. Actually, I'll rewrite that. Keep that up there. Okay, fourth conjugation. I believe you guys had one verb from this set, and it is impedio, impedire. Okay. So, you'll notice that the I is in front of the O again. This is because it's not actually causing any kind of hiatus or anything. It actually sounds fine to just say impedio, so they kept the I there. No harm done. This will not always be the case, but with the fourth, it'll often be the case that it's an I-O, okay? So as we go through this one, we see impedio here. Impedis with our S ending. Impedit in our third person singular. Impedimus. Impeditis. And finally, impediunt. Now note that there's going to be in the fourth conjugation a possibility of an I-O and an I-U, okay? But you still can follow O for eyes, U. You might just have to insert another I in there, okay? So I think that pretty much takes care of this. Let's go on to the next slide and we'll see what's going on. All right, so now that we know how to create verb endings and how they're going to look and why, let's do a practice one. So the first thing we do is we look at our dictionary entry here. We see irito, irritare. So we look at that A right there, right? And we know that irito, the first part, is going to be your first person singular, okay? And this means I stir up, or I excite, okay? We get a word irritate from this word. So let's go to the second one. We say, okay, remember we have an A-R-E ending up here. So we have our A there. We had that S ending that we knew. Okay. We say, okay, it means you stir up. It's the second person singular. Now third person singular. Keep going. Boom. We have an A there for our first conjugation. And we have a T ending. So he, she, or it stirs up. Notice these are not complete sentences. These are just the verb form. So it probably stirred up something, or somebody probably stirred up something. But we're just doing verb forms, so we don't need to worry about a complete sentence here yet, okay? Irritamus is the next one, okay? Mus ending, we got our A vowel still. And remember, first person plural is we, so we stir up. Irritatis. Y'all stir up, or you can just say you. You don't have to use y'all. I just like to do that to make it very clear. Okay, and then our last one. Irritant. They stir up. Okay, not too bad, I hope. If you are still having trouble, I would actually go back to the last slide and then watch this slide again. And I think that you'll start to get it, okay? So let's go to the second to last slide, I should say. All right, now that we know our verb forms, we need to ask a question. Do we always need a nominative subject? The short answer, I guess the answer if we're using the word always, is no. No, we do not. Sometimes, and this happens in Italian too, so don't think this is just unique to Latin. This is an interesting thing that happened in a lot of Romance languages, is that the subject can often be built into the verb, okay? So if we see things like viros et feminas cognosco, you'll note by looking at our cases, we have our accusatives here. We have a conjunction connecting them, okay? Men and the women. We have cognosco with an O ending, meaning it's first person singular, but then our sentence ends. We don't actually have a nominative subject. But if you remember from the previous couple slides, we don't have a third person singular verb here, okay? We have this O ending, and as we translated them in the last slide, we can translate here as well. So you would say, I recognize. And then our direct objects. Oops. There you go. So you note that we used I recognize for the form of cognosco. The O ending clued us in to the fact that it is first person singular. And the first person singular pronoun is I, so you do not even need a nominative noun. You just need that verb ending in order to know that, okay? Cool. Let's take a look at patriam regitis non sed populum. So here we look through and we say, okay, we have our accusative ending with an AM. We have a tis ending, regitis, okay? So that that necessarily means that we have a second person plural. And then we have sed non populum on the other side. Now, if you remember from a few slides ago, we looked at what would we do if we only had a little bit of our expectation on one side. So here we have a direct object and with right, an accusative, but we don't have a subject or a verb. So what are we going to do? We're going to gap. Now, do we have a subject to gap? Again, no, where it's built into the verb, okay? So we're gapping our subject and a verb with one word, okay? Now, when you're labeling, and we can do this for the first sentence as well, you would have to say S and V above this verb because there's no represented subject in any of the verbs, or words, sorry. So you'd have to label the verb as both the subject and the verb because we say that the subject is built in. So over here, we would say, okay, we have our direct object here, okay, and the subject and the verb are built in to regitis, okay? And we know that's second person plural, so that's y'all rule the country. Sed non populum, but not the people. And typically when this happens, there are revolutions when you formally are ruling a country, but not the actual people. Okay. Hope that makes sense. I hope you understand. These verb endings can also be the subjects of the sentence, even if there is no nominative noun given in the sentence, okay? That's the point I'm making here. Let's wrap it up. All right, so lastly, we have a picture of Horace right here, okay? Horace is quite possibly my favorite author, and he quoted something that you guys might have heard before, and you might have seen on a movie by Robin Williams called The Dead Poets Society. And that phrase is carpe diem. Okay, and I thought I'd bring this up because you guys now have the word dies in your vocabulary. Okay. And you'll see that the em ending is accusative singular. So carpe, it means to pluck, or we often translate to seize the day, okay? So you might have heard that before, but Horace, my man Horace up here, was the first person to really write that in Latin, and that's where we get that common phrase. And valete is, it's much like salvete, except it means goodbye, but you see the ete ending, the ete ending, is to all of you, and if you were to respond to me, you would say, Wale, as in goodbye. So, until next time, valete et carpe diem.